through many years of excellent teaching at Front Range Community College, working on the board of, let's see, I'm missing one.
That was Secure World Foundation.
And now she is one of the main teachers of science and teacher education at Western Governors University. So how many people have even heard of Western Governors University?
Yeah, like no one. That's okay.
This is one of the best kept secrets of good quality online education. It was founded, I forget how many years ago. 11 years ago by a consortium of, I guess it's Western Governors of Western
Actually, States. I'm sorry, I misspoke. 16, but the Teachers College is 11. So 16 years ago, 19 governors of Western States said, we need a better way to train our workforce.
And so they wanted to develop very high quality online education that would be targeted towards real substantial careers and at a reasonable price and in a way that working adults could be able to fit into busy schedules. And very recently, Suzanne and her program got reviewed by the National Council for Teacher Quality, and among 2,400 teacher education programs around the United States, her program was voted number one in the best quality for doing content. Results coming out of that. It's great to see the recognition that comes with that. And Western Governors now has 46,000 students. And Suzanne is one of the most wonderful teachers, and we're very fortunate to have her here today.
Thank you. You know, after that kind of buildup, it's really hard to be modest, but I'm going to try anyway. Thank you for coming out. This is a gorgeous summer evening. It is the day before solstice, and Pablo, in fact, helped me realize that at 4:51 a.m. tomorrow is officially solstice. But of course, the sun doesn't rise until 5:29. So if you really want to see the solstice at sunrise, you have to drive east a little bit, but watch which time zone you're in, because things may change on you. But anyway, the point is, it's a delight to be here. I adore Little Thompson, and I'm always delighted to see how the volunteers improve it. Because every single time I come, it's a different, better place because of your work. So let's have another round of applause for everyone. And everything here has been donated, right? From the concrete for the foundation to the telescope itself has been donated. So it's truly a sweat equity effort that is successful. And what I'd like to talk about tonight is the Kepler Space Telescope. Oh, wait, before I get into that, speaking of sweat equity, if you don't mind walking up the stairs here after our talk, when it's actually dark, you get to look through the 24-inch telescope at Saturn and hopefully some other really nice targets. So, Saturn and its rings, they never get old. Who's seen Saturn's rings before? Can you tell us that? Oh, excellent, excellent. So some of you haven't. You're in for a treat. Okay, so what we're going to talk about today is the Kepler Space Telescope. And the wonderful thing about Kepler is it's homegrown. I'll talk to you in a minute just how Colorado-based it is, but the answer is very. And what this first slide does is tell you really what it looks like and what it's about. It's in orbit around Earth right now as we speak, but really it's just a bucket. So you see this opening? This is like the opening of your telescope right over there. And when you take the cover off the telescope, it's actually an empty tube until you get to the back part. Well, the same thing here. When we open the cover, it's just an empty tube all the way down, and this is where all the interesting stuff happens. But this is empty. So when we say a telescope is a light bucket, it really is. It's bucket shaped. And you can walk around with a bucket in your house and turn it into a pretend telescope. And then, of course, you're going to learn how to use a real one if you come hang out here. So the interesting thing about the Kepler Space Telescope is it only has one instrument called a photometer. Phot, like photosynthesis, means light. And meter is to measure. So all this does is measure light. It doesn't take pictures, there's no camera. It just lets you know how much light is hitting the detector at the bottom here. And then an antenna sends that information back to the controller's arm. Okay, I'm trying to forward the slide, let's see. All right. So I can do all sorts of cool stuff, but I can't forward the slide. So I'm gonna have someone in the back.
Maite, we're missing the, I think the plug is still there.
There we go, okay.
Thanks, Jeff.
Here's an RF stuff.
There we go. RF is radio frequency. Radio is part of the electromagnetic spectrum. In all the colors of sunlight, the colors you can see, like orange and yellow, and the colors you can't see, like X-ray and radio. So there's all sorts of really interesting stuff with sunlight. So what Kepler wants to do is look at the sunlight that comes from other stars. And instead of looking at all stars, it's just looking at a particular part of the sky. And when it was first launched a few years ago, that part of the sky looked like this. So for those of you who can read a star chart, see, whoops, sorry, in the wrong direction. Normally, when you look at the night sky, all right, it's just not working. It's on. So when we look at the night sky, there we go, we see the white stars against the black background. But when you make a map, it's easier to turn the colors around. So you've got white paper, and you don't want to use up all that ink, so you make the stars black. And so right between the stars Vega and the constellation Cygnus and the star Deneb, that's where Kepler was supposed to look, and did look for quite a while. When it was first built, it was here in Colorado. And it was built by the people at Ball Aerospace in Boulder and Lakewood. And it was launched by the United Launch Alliance, which is based here in Colorado, and then operated by LASP at the University of Colorado at Boulder. And when it was first launched in 2009, so that's 5 years ago, it was, did I say it orbited Earth before? I misspoke. It orbited the sun, and it's still in orbit around the sun, but really close to Earth's orbit. So the idea was seasons would be important. So since tomorrow is the solstice, if Kepler was still behaving the way it was supposed to behave when it was launched, then tomorrow would be a big deal, because it would be when they would start with, what they would call their summer roll. Well, what this would mean is that it would turn so that it could see those stars, because when you go around the sun, you end up looking at different things. And you guys, how about I have the four of you, because you're my friend, can I have you as volunteers? So I'm going to be the sun, and I want you to be on all sides of me. And if you don't want to do it, that's okay. But if you do want to do it, it would be great. How about you two? Will you volunteer? Excellent. So I'd like you to be on this side of me. Okay? Does anyone else want to volunteer? I can take adults too, but I'd rather have a kid. All right. Come on over. Excellent. Oh, perfect. Perfect, perfect. Okay. I'm going to ask you to be behind me, please. And I want you to stand right there, and you're going to be in front, okay? So if I'm the sun, you have to tell me. If you look past me, what do you see? You have to look at me, because I'm the sun. But you have to look past me. What do you see on the other side of me? that wall over there with all those cool dots? Yeah, and each one of those dots is a star or a star system. So that's really cool.
Solar.
Yeah, could be a solar system. And what do you see when you, sorry, when you look at me, but you're looking past me, what do you see over there? Do you see light?
What do you see? If I get out of the way, you can see past me.
It is, but it's whatever's on the screen. Yeah, and what can you see when you look past me? People! So here you are around the sun means you're looking at different things. Hey, thank you guys. You can go sit down again. I'll think it's over. So point of view is important. And one of the interesting things about Kepler is it doesn't exactly share Earth's orbit around the sun. The Kepler orbit is actually a little bit bigger. So every year, because Kepler has to go further around the sun than Earth does, Kepler's been getting a little bit behind us. So Earth and Kepler are never going to run into each other. You don't have to worry about an accident, because Kepler is going to keep drifting behind us, which is okay, because that means we're getting out of the way. Remember, I had to get out of the way. And that means Kepler will have a better and better view of things. So this is what was supposed to happen. Problem is, as soon as it started making really exciting discoveries, like hot Jupiters and all sorts of other new exoplanets, exoplanets are planets that orbit stars other than ours. It was so wonderful, we're getting tons and tons of data, and then it broke. So in 2013, which was just last year, it was May 2013, Kepler really broke. And I was like, oh man, is it over? Are we never gonna get the data again? Well, that's okay, we got lots of good data, we can still look through it, but boy, wouldn't it be nice if we could somehow figure out how to redesign the program so that this marvelous piece of technology that's giving us such cool information will keep doing that? So they did. They came up with a brand new program called K2. I'm not going to get into the details of what it is, but what's really interesting is K2 is going to be pushed by sunlight. Can you imagine that sunlight would have enough pressure to push a spacecraft into the right position? But NASA's got amazing engineers. And so the answer is yes. If you balance it just right, like if you have a pencil or even this thing and I balance it just right, have you ever seen somebody spin a basketball on their fingertip? If it balances just right, even a spinning satellite will stay perfectly balanced and right where you want it to go. Well, gee, that's exactly what they're doing here. Now, this little fine print here in the corner says, conceptual illustration, meaning this isn't what it really looks like, this is just a drawing. Solar disturbance. The actual disturbance is due to photon pressure, not the solar wind. So the sun has something called the solar wind. And what that means is the sun is constantly spitting on you. And you don't even feel it, do you? But it is. It's spitting solar particles, like protons and electrons and neutrons. These are parts of an atom. And solar protons really have a lot of charge and mass. So there's a lot of energy associated with that. And there's a wind. Have you ever talked to somebody and you had to step out of the way because the person had garlic for lunch? You can smell it. Right? So the solar wind does that. The solar wind is the sun's breath. And it's constantly blowing on you. And not just on Earth. It blows past Mars, it blows past Pluto. Sun's got a really strong breath. Can you imagine garlic breath for the entire solar system? Well, maybe with that image. But if you ignore the solar wind, which is the breath, and you just focus on the light coming out of the sun, turns out light can push you and can help orient you. So you use the software on the spacecraft to help keep everything balanced, and then use what the sun already puts out to make it do its job. So now the new mission is to look within the plane of our own solar system. The initial mission was to look out away from where Earth and Mars and the other planets are. That's okay. Now we've got to reorient to look in the same areas. It's still just like you guys were looking beyond me, looking beyond everything in our solar system to what's far away to see if there are new solar systems. And there are. And the good news is, now we're looking beyond our own galaxy. And we're looking at stars. And that wasn't part of the plan to begin with. And because we're getting all this new data, now we know where to point new telescopes, like the James Webb Space Telescope and others. So the people at NASA said, you know what, we don't care if we get anybody's approval, we're just going to go ahead and do this. And so a couple weeks ago, they actually got the approval. Yeah, you can go ahead and do that. So there are five ways you look for a planet around a star other than our own. But before I get into that, does anybody have any questions? Yeah?
Does K2 program mean you're no longer using the gyros that died?
That's correct, because the gyros died and you can't use them. And a gyro is a gyroscope that helps keep the spacecraft pointed the way it's supposed to be pointed. Because it broke, we can't point it that way, and that's why we have to have the whole new K2 system. Other questions?
Yes, just one. How was the program given to Kepler?
When we say that LASP operates it, it does that for NASA. So this was always a NASA project with NASA funding. But LASP, which is the Laboratory for Atmospheric and Space Physics at the University of Colorado at Boulder, they get to actually push the buttons and do all the stuff we need to do to make it work. So it's sort of like your dad pays for the car, but you get to drive it. But that was a great question. Any others?
Well,
yeah.
But, so my question is, even though the telescope mechanism broke, they still had ways to control it, is that true?
Yes, because the software was just fine, and other engines, you know, if you want to use a little bit of fuel to move your spacecraft, they still have that fuel on board to do that. So they could still turn the spacecraft, they just couldn't keep it pointed where it was supposed to be pointed. Because the pointer is broken. Okay, so let's get to and we're going to make this fast because I don't want to bore you guys to death. But there are five ways, and one of my favorite ways of finding a planet is to wobble. So anybody who wants to, you can wobble. Do you remember the old toy, Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down? Okay, so I want you guys to wobble. What's making you, okay, don't get sick. I don't want anyone to be seasick. But what makes a star wobble is if there's a planet nearby. So the orange thing in the center is the star, and the yellow thing, because whoever did this didn't remember that stars are supposed to be yellow, they made the planet yellow, that's okay. You end up with a big planet can make a star wobble. And the more it wobbles, the bigger the planet. It could very well be that in this case, there are two stars. I'm getting ahead of myself, let me go back. So if there are two stars, then the second star, which is called a binary, can make the first star wobble. Which one's the first star? The one with the most mass. So just like in politics, mass is like money. Whoever has the most mass has the most influence and wins the argument. So whoever has the most mass gets to be the primary star in the center of the solar system, and then all the smaller stars or planets or dwarf planets or whatever, they all go around the center of mass of the system. And if that first star is big enough, then the center of mass is in that star, just like we have in our solar system. And so we get to say the sun is the center of our solar system. Really, it's a center of mass of all the stuff in the solar system, but let's keep it simple. So, the more wobble of the orange star, we know the bigger the yellow body, or the more objects there are that are making a wobble. Does that make sense? Does anybody have any questions on that? Yeah?
How does the planet make the star wobble?
Ah. All right, I'm going to need some volunteers again. All right, you too. Anybody else? Okay, this is good. Yes, come on up. My usual. All right, so this time, I'm going to step out of the way, And I want you guys right here. And because you asked the question, you get to be the star. Is that okay? Okay, so I need you right in front of me, please. All right, so we have our star right here. Please face the crowd, our star. And you are the planets going in orbit. So let's see. You can be in any order. So who wants to be closest? Okay, I'm going to let you be closest. And then I'm going to let you be second, and you get to be on the outside. Okay, you come up here. All right, so you guys are going to come this way and orbit around. So I'm going to get really far out of the way, and I'm going to let you orbit around the star. And look, this actually happens. Sometimes we do get objects orbiting in different directions, and that's perfectly fine. So it's not everything. But see, this is an ecliptic plane. Everything's in the plane. And star, you get to not only spin, but because you're wobbling, you've got to go like this. You've got to put one foot in front of the other and kind of make this square or circle around you. You've got to make a little circle too, because their gravitational pull is yanking you as well. So everything in a solar system moves all at once. And remember, you really want to get dizzy. You get to spin while you go around. Every single one of you gets to spin. That is a dynamic solar system right now. All right, thank you, dynamic solar system. That's the center of the whole solar system. So the more objects, the bigger circle you're going to have to make.
Thank you very much.
Cool. So the next way is the Doppler effect. Who's heard an ambulance go really low pitches? Yeah. Can anybody make that sound? But then when the object gets further and further away, it gets really low pitch. So do that to make it go really high pitch and then really low pitch. Yes! That's it, that's it, excellent. And that's what we use. But instead of doing it with sound, we do it with light. So the blue shift is something's coming closer, and the red shift is something's going away. And the more red, the more it's going away, and the faster it's moving. So we can tell speed, we can tell direction, we can tell if it's rotating, we can tell all sorts of cool stuff. The way Kepler works is to use something called light curves, and I'll talk about that more in just a minute. But basically, as the small object gets in front of the big object, it blocks out some of its light, and so the light, remember, all Kepler can do is measure light. The light curves down. And the more it curves down, we know the bigger the object is. And then when it comes all the way across, it goes right back up. The light level goes right back up to what it had been. Now, if you've got a real steep cutoff from, there's a lot of light, there's not a lot of light. That means there's no atmosphere on that planet. But if it's real gentle, that tells us that's a thin atmosphere or that's a thick atmosphere. So even though all we're doing is looking at how much light, it tells us all this information, which is so cool. The other thing is, and this is a new technique, validation by multiplicity, means if you've got a whole lot of light curves, well, one of them could be another star. But if you have a whole lot of light curves, that means you've got a whole family of planets. If you've got a whole family of planets, one of them is probably close to being Earth-like. We want to look at those solar systems. And so there again, Kepler isn't just looking at, oh cool, we found a planet. Now Kepler is looking at, we found planets, and we want to look at the ones that we think are really interesting. And this will help us find them. And then the fifth way, which is my favorite, is direct observation. When you look through a telescope, you want to see something cool, right? So this is cool. The light from the star has been blocked out. So that sort of dull blue disk in the middle, that would really be a bright star that would hurt your eyes. So they put a cover over that so you can't see that. So you can see the planets, and there are three planets around this star. And you're looking at planets around another star. That's amazing. Do you know that you're the only people on Earth? I mean, honestly, when I was a little kid, which was a long time ago, we didn't have this technology. We couldn't look at stars around other planets. And now we're like, look, more planets, right? It gets so commonplace, but it shouldn't be, because this is exciting. Questions before I go to the next one? Yeah.
So on the light curve, those Kepler have a spectroscopy capabilities.
No,
it's Kepler. Light intensity.
This is it. This is all you get. Yes? Because we realized, wait a minute, there are a lot more binary star systems than we thought. So we're taking lots and lots of data, because this is a new, exciting discovery. But no, you can't tell the star apart from the planet unless there are a whole lot of dips, and then you know you've got a solar system. And you had a question. Yes?
I've heard that there are over 1,000 exoplanets identified at this point, or is there...
Yes, and we'll get to that. Just, I do have a statistic, so let me get there. So here's how you come in. Those of you who like to play on the internet can actually do real science for NASA. This is from a site called planethunters.org, which is part of a larger set of websites called the Zooniverse. Zooniverse.org. Zooniverse. Because there's a whole zoo of cool stuff to do in biology and anthropology and astronomy. So what they do is they give you a little tutorial, and the whole thing takes like 10, 15 minutes to go through the tutorial. And they teach you how to read these light curves. You can do it. And so the people at NASA who don't have the budget, the people at universities who are running out of grad students that they have to pay, they don't want to pay grad students cheap, said, well, let you do it. You have infinite patience, and you don't get cranky, because if you get tired of it, you walk away from the computer, and then you come back, and we're all excited to do it again. So they actually teach you how to read these things. And they teach you what to look for and what the characteristics are and to watch out for those binary stars so you don't get fooled. And see these gaps, these sort of black places? That's when the telescope wasn't looking there, so it was sleeping or just looking someplace else. You can ignore that. So you can yourself, I mean, I drew these red circles. Right? So you can yourself say, oh, I see a dip here, and here, and here. And that means you're the one making the discovery. And your data is put together with the data of lots of other people doing the same thing. And there have been lots of research papers proving that amateurs do just as good a job or even better than professionals, because the professionals are distracted with getting money through grants and begging the government to not shut down their programs and stuff like that. Whereas you've got infinite energy and talent, and you get to make those discoveries that we then try to put into some sort of idea of, wow, is there an Earth-like planet somewhere? And this is my favorite explanation of what's Earth-like. What can you survive? So to be habitable means, can you live there? And really, the only definition that anyone has agreed on is it's where life is not impossible. That doesn't mean life is there. It doesn't mean life could be there or has been there in the past. It just means the conditions are such that it's not impossible for life to be there. So, in between the red line over here and the red line over there, these are the habitable zones of lots of planets, including this one that might look well, the one on the blue line labeled Earth, you might recognize that one. Okay, so what we've got here are lots of different star colors and sizes, because stars do come in a whole variety. Just like people come in different shapes and sizes and colors, so do stars and planets. So here are the star shapes, here are the planet shapes. To answer your question, when I made this slide, there were almost 1,000 planets confirmed, 966. If you go on the website today, it's probably even closer to 1,000. I think the number would be like 974, because they keep increasing the number every few days. The planet candidates, more than 3,800. And those binary stars that they started to track, more than 2,000. So Kepler, even though it doesn't work the way we thought it was going to work, is getting us all sorts of great new data. And you know what? Failure is part of the road to success. Sometimes when something breaks and you have to fix it, you make it better because you made it different from what you thought. And that's always a good thing. So the planets, it turns out, the easiest ones to find are the biggest ones, the ones that are the size of Jupiter or bigger. And those are sometimes called hot Jupiters if they're really close to the star. Sometimes they're even called gas giants. We think just like Jupiter, they're mostly made of gas. But they're, it turns out, are a whole lot of Neptune-sized planets. Neptune is a whole lot smaller than Jupiter. And if you see on the chart there, see the blue dot close to Jupiter? That's Neptune. That's the actual size comparison. Neptune, we don't think of as being small, but it is compared to Jupiter. And it's got more ice because it's further away from the sun. So Neptune is an ice giant. Well, it turns out you get a lot of ice giants. Then we get objects that are between the size of Neptune and the size of Earth, and so we call those super-Earths. And guess what? Kepler's found a lot of super-Earths. But here's the exciting one. Kepler has found nearly 200, well, more like 150, Earth-sized planets. That's exciting. We're not alone. We're not the only kind of planet that could potentially sustain life. So here's, I'm a planetary geologist by training, so this is what gets me really, really, really excited. We used to think there were only two kinds of planets in the solar system. The ones that are like Earth, that are called terrestrial, and the ones that are like Jupiter, that we call Jovian. Now, the Earth-like planets have a metal inside. And I know you don't think about Earth being a big magnet with metal inside, but it is. And then we've got rock, and then we've got water and atmosphere and all that other good stuff. When you have a Jupiter-type planet, guess what? You've got a planet just like Earth inside. It's like when you eat a candy and you realize, wait a minute, there's a Tootsie Roll center in here. Or there's some sort of candy that you didn't anticipate in the center. A long time ago, people thought planets like Jupiter were just gas all the way through. That's not true. You've got a planet Earth, and it's not surrounded just by gas. Here's the planet Earth. You've got layers of liquid, like slush, and then you get gas being in the outer layers. And of course, the cool thing about these Jupiter type is they've all got rings, ring particles made of ice and dirt. They've got lots and lots of moons. And each one of those moons is an exciting world to explore. There could be life on the moons. So when we talk about other solar systems, we're not just talking about exoplanets, we're talking about exomoons around those exoplanets. And life could be on any of those things, depending on what the conditions are like. And so, let me give you some numbers. Remember I talked to you about Neptune? Well, Uranus is even a little bit smaller than that. So it's about 14 or 15 times as big as Earth. When we talk about a planet, we have to include our dwarf planets. And they can be really small compared to Earth, but still have that same structure. Still have rock on the inside, and then water or ice around it, and then more rock and an atmosphere. And by the way, there's going to be a spacecraft going to Ceres. It's on its way to Ceres right now. We'll get there next year. So I'll be able to talk to you more about that. But there's a third category that Kepler discovered. Gas dwarfs in between the size of Neptune and Earth, made of rock in the middle and gas on the outside. That was so cool. We didn't know they existed. 5 years ago? I couldn't talk. 5 months ago, I couldn't talk to you about this. This only got announced a few weeks ago. Any questions?
Yeah, this is about the light sensing. So what happens if, so would the light curves go like above like a mountain? If like a star went in front of the planet?
If you had something really, well, yeah, that's a good point. He said, if a star goes in front of the planet, would you get an up curve, a mountain of light? The thing is that even though some planets give off radiation, Jupiter gives off a whole lot of radio frequency radiation. That's how we can use a radio telescope to look at Jupiter. But other than that, lights generally don't give off their own, planets don't give off their own light. So you can't look for a star by finding the planet and then looking for the light mountain because you don't know the planet is there. So planets are actually kind of dark. And you're right, if you have two stars going in front of each other, could one be brighter than the other? Yes. But we're always, with the technology we're using, we're only going to be able to see the down dips. We cannot yet see any up dip. But one exception, and that is solar flares. If your star is really energetic, remember I talked to you about the solar wind? So if it's really shooting off a lot of solar flares, we will get those up spikes, but then we know we have a really active star. We don't know from that that we have another star. Does that work? Okay. Yes, sir. You.
How can
light
push spacecraft through space?
Isn't that cool? You wouldn't think it does, but it does. It's called photon pressure. And think of it this way. Have you ever stood in front of a fan? Like, pretend this telescope here was a fan. Wouldn't my hair start blowing out? Well, nothing's pushing on my hair, except it is. The wind from the fan would be pushing my hair totally out of shape. And if the wind was strong enough, it would push me out of place too, right? That would be wind pressure from the fan. Photon pressure works the same way. I know it's a little hard to understand, but it really does work. Yeah. Discovered maybe there's a whole third new category of planets. planet that we didn't know about. Because we don't have one of these in our solar system, they're not needed. But they are in these other solar systems where the other stars have different characteristics. So you're absolutely right. Yeah?
I'll ask somewhat of a facetious question. How is the scientific community in general digesting the information that 20 years ago there weren't any planets, exoplanets? Today there are approaching over 1,000. How is the scientific community addressing changes to the Drake equation?
They keep having to rewrite the textbooks, and then they give up and realize as soon as it's printed, it's wrong. So everybody's doing online publications. But you bring up a good point. Of course, these objects have always been there. Just because we didn't know they were there doesn't mean that they haven't always been there. They've been there. We are just finally noticing them. Like that dust bunny under the bed. It's been there. You just didn't see it. So, if you're a scientist, you actually get excited about change. I was at a scientific conference about 20 years ago when a NASA guy came in saying, I found the latest results from Mars. And the person who was about to announce a brand new beautiful map of Mars had to actually take the paper and rip it in half. And he was okay with that because it means now he gets to work on a bigger, better map of Mars. So scientists actually love new data and love new interpretations of old data. What they don't like is when their pet idea isn't the favorite one anymore. That they don't like.
What about the Drake equation? Are they looking at that term?
Of course. The Drake equation, for those of you who don't know, was developed by Frank Drake around 50 years ago, where he basically said, well, I don't know, but I think if I wanted to figure out if there was a civilization like ours on any other planet, what would be the factors I'd have to look for? And he came up with this long equation because he kept thinking of all these things you have to look for. And that famous Drake equation was always just something he made up. Well, now we have some actual numbers to plug in, which is exciting. So the more data we get, the better kind of Drake equation we can get, and the more discussion and interpretation of that, so that we can really zoom in on, you look like a really good place to live, and you, not so much, right? But that's so, you know, more data is always good for scientists, and more data to argue about. And scientists are really good at arguing. Okay, so how do you come in? Well, once you learn how to use a radio telescope, because you come here and you play with the new setup, then you can go to a website like SETILive.org. SETI is Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. And they're based in Mountain View, California. And so they actually put out radio frequency data from their Allen telescope array and let you, again, look through the data and see if you find anything interesting. I know nothing about radio frequency, so to me this is all blank. But I'm sure there's data in there. I just don't know how to read it. It's like an ultrasound. Does anybody have an ultrasound for any reason? That looks like just blurry lines. But then the technician comes in and says, that's a baby, and that's a boy. And you're like, I can't see a thing. So let's talk about those stars. This is called a Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, when in fact the real work was done by women in the basement of the Harvard-Smithsonian Observatory, women like Annie John Cannon. And what they did was they figured out, is there a relationship between the color of a star and its temperature and how bright it is? And the answer is yes. But since we're running a little late on time, I'm going to skip that and just say that our sun is, let's see, can I get my laser pointer to work if I get real close up? Yes, here's our sun right here. So we're a yellow star. We're midway through what's called the main sequence, which is where most stars live. Not all of them, but most. And so we have a very middle-aged, middle-of-the-road star. But you can have red stars that are big, and we call them giants, or even supergiants. You can have blue giants. You can have blue dwarfs, or white dwarfs. And you can have red dwarfs. Dwarf is tiny. Giant is big. Red is cool. Blue and white are hot. It's really all you need to know. Turns out, most of the stars in the Milky Way galaxy, which is our galaxy, are red dwarfs. 7 out of 10 are red dwarfs. And all of the stars around us, pretty much, are red dwarfs. And I'm sorry, I grew up watching a British TV comedy called Red Dwarf, so it is hard for me to take this seriously. Until we get to Kepler 186. So this is the 186th planet, excuse me, star, 186th star identified by Kepler. The A is the star itself. And then as you get further out, you get B, C, D, E. So these are the objects or planets that orbit. So by the time you're at F, you're at the fifth planet out from the star. And Kepler-186f is 10% bigger than Earth. To give you an idea, we're about 10% bigger than Venus. A little bit bigger than that. But so it's like looking at Earth versus Venus, and we're the smaller body, and Kepler-186 is the bigger one. It probably has an atmosphere, but we don't know. We're guessing it does. We don't know about liquid water. It's in a part of the Kepler-186 system where water could exist, but we don't have any proof that water does exist. And we can't say anything about the rocks because we don't know. We need to have a spectroscope or a camera or some other detector give us some information about whether there are rocks and what they're like, and maybe there's ice. We don't know. Ice can behave like rock, so ice is okay. But we know it exists, and this is the most Earth-like planet we've ever, ever found. So, finally, my last slide, yay! This is the first, and by the way, this is just a drawing. We have no idea if Kepler-186 actually looks like this. It can be a totally different color, it can be a totally different thing. But what we know is it goes around a red dwarf star. It's as Earth-like as anything we've ever seen. It could have liquid water on the surface. And that means it could have plants. And you know, in red light, a green plant would look black. Can you imagine plants that are black? That's what you would have on this planet. They'd be black plants. And that would be really healthy and good. If it was any color other than black, it would be sick. So you want healthy black plants on this planet. If there are any, we don't know. But this way, we actually now have a good target for, gee, is there going to be intelligent life elsewhere? Well, it would be this kind of planet. And now we know where to look, thanks to Kepler. And thank you for coming out and spending your evening with me. Anybody who wants a copy of this talk, it'll be on the LTO website, and you can look at all the references. But so those of you who have to write papers, always cite and reference your work. All right, thank you. Anyone on Kepler-186f would probably have infrared or microwave right in the center. That would be exciting. You could see, it would be night vision goggles all the time. Yeah. Yes?
Two-part question. Where in the sky is this star that has this particular planet?
That's an excellent question, and I did not look that up, so I don't know.
And the second question, since we've identified that as a possible place where quote-unquote life would exist, what plans are in the offing to try to work with spectroscopy or other means of determining what it's like?
Right. We have space-based telescopes like James Webb Space Telescope coming up, but more importantly, we have ground-based telescopes. There are lots of them being built in South America, in Argentina and Chile, and even in Australia and South Africa. So all sorts of new ground-based telescopes here on Earth that are designed to look at different places and different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. And so when you use all these different imaging techniques, and you need at least three different observations to confirm a discovery. I mean, this all isn't just Kepler. The Gemini Observatory, which is actually two telescopes working together as one, they have to confirm everything that Kepler sees. And the European Southern Observatory has to confirm. Yeah. Right, so it's not just, oh, I found something. It's, I think I found something and I need you to look and tell me if it's right, and I need you to look and tell me if it's right, and you too. And so once you get all this agreement, then we can say, this is confirmed. So all of this got started by Kepler, but we've got all these other telescopes that we currently use and will be using. And of course, the technology always improves, so we get to see more stuff. Yeah?
So to see these light curves, we have to kind of be parallel with the ecliptic plane of that solar system. So can we be very far off?
You know, this is the thing. Early information from Kepler was outside our ecliptic plane. So it's like instead of looking straight ahead, we're looking up over there. But because of K2, now we've got to look in our solar system straight ahead. And so yes, we're only looking at solar systems that are lined up with us. And there could be lots of solar systems that we can't see because they're behind us and we just can't see them. Yes?
Why are all these new technical telescopes being built in the southern hemisphere?
Well, part of it is they've got the land.
Oh, okay.
And the willing workforce. But also, you want to be at really high elevation, and you want to be where the air is really, really dry. And in the northern hemisphere, it tends to be more rainy.
Okay.
Right? You've got to go where the deserts are. And that's actually right along the Tropic of Cancer and right along the Tropic of Capricorn. And then you have to look at, well, what land masses do you have? And what countries are there? And who's willing to fund it? And so it boiled down to a lot of them are in the southern hemisphere because most of the telescopes we have right now are in the northern hemisphere, and we don't have much in the southern. So we want to have balanced coverage. Yes?
If put on a planet that wasn't too different from Earth, but maybe slightly less oxygen, over generations, would humans be able to adapt to be much less oxygen?
That's a great question. If you put a human on a different planet where the oxygen content of the atmosphere was different, would humans adapt? They would have to, because otherwise they'd die. So, but I mean, this is the theory of evolution through natural selection. Those who don't die do survive to pass to their children the characteristics that let them survive. So yes, that human family would adapt to less oxygen or to looking more in infrared than in visible light. All these other changes, and after a while, they wouldn't be human anymore, they'd be a different species. Which is okay, that happens over time. But yeah, you could, with technology, have somebody live on another planet, but what happens if their oxygen generator breaks? Then they die, but maybe the next generation is okay breathing a little bit less oxygen. And of course, you do that here. It's really funny, who's visited sea levels? Has anybody been to New York or California? Right? And doesn't the air feel thick? Doesn't it feel weird? And it's like moist. So we already do this adaptation to less oxygen just because we live in Colorado. That was a good question. Yes?
Do we yet know if solar systems orbit around each other?
What you're saying is, would solar systems orbit around each other? So would you have a solar system around each star of a binary star system and have them moving, you know, around each other? No, and the reason I'm saying no is, remember, everything in that system goes around one center of mass. So you could, in fact, have planets and moons going around a star, and then all of that together moves around the center of mass with that other system. But by the time you get a system that complex, it's not very habitable. So it is theoretically potential, but it's not likely. You're more likely to have too many gravitational perturbations, meaning that the tug of war between all the planets is such that it would be really hard to have stable orbits, and stable orbits in places where you can have things like liquid water would be even harder to do.
So therefore, each solar system is standalone?
Pretty much. But remember, each solar system, if we use ours as a baseline, each solar system has like a million objects in it. Only a few big ones. Our solar system only has 8 big planets, but we have up to 50 dwarf planets, and we've got all those moons, so another 150 dwarf planet-sized moons. And then you finally get to all the small objects, like comets and asteroids. So you end up, by the time you count everything up, with a million objects. So just a few big guys and lots of little guys. And that's a lot of stuff to run into each other. Yes?
So that means, following up on your question, does that mean that people who are more used to Colorado, does that mean that they would have a better chance to survive?
Yeah, and this is why the United States Olympic Committee has their training center in Colorado. Because you really, you know, you're developing a better human who breathes less oxygen, you know, has a more efficient heart and all the rest of it. So yes, continue exercising at high elevation here in Colorado, and then when you compete in the Olympics, you win. Yeah.
What type of percentage that I look at for finding planets that we actually how many stars they observed, how many signs of oceans?
You know, the number changes daily, because 5 years ago, I would have said, oh, isn't this exciting? We've looked at 200 stars and we've identified 5 candidates. Well, now we're in thousands. So the numbers keep going up. We keep looking at more and more stars and finding more and more stuff. But in terms of the percentage, that number is also going up, and I don't know what it is off the top of my head.
Star, where it would be success. How far away is that?
Oh, that is, boy, I have to remember. Let me go back.
How far away from us is
Yeah, I know, I'm trying to remember. I think it's something like 160 light years. I could be wrong.
Is it in the Milky Way? Is it?
Yes, it's in the Milky Way, and it's not very far from us. But you're right, I don't remember exactly how many light years, but it's a surprisingly small number of light years.
160 light years is incredible. Because we did a study for NASA in the 1990s to go up to Alpha Centauri, which is only 4.5 light years away. That would take, with current technology, it would take about 50,000 years for humans to go there. So now we have a factor of 40 longer. So now we're looking at.
Right, we can't visit anytime soon, but within a 500 light year radius around Earth, there are lots of these stars and lots of these planets. So, yeah, we're definitely not alone. Whether there's anything there on these planets, we can't answer. But the possibility, that Drake equation question of, is it possible that there is life on these planets and life that could be technologically advanced enough to pay attention to us and that kind of stuff, every time we get numbers that go up, those numbers go up too. So it's getting more likely. But I'm not going to say for sure there's anything. Yes?
So if we were able to develop a telescope strong enough to see this planet, thankfully, so we would see an older version of it?
Yes. And it would be however many light years that is. A light year is how long it takes for one photon, which is a little package of light energy, to get from a star, like our sun, in one Earth year. And of course, why is it a light year? Because it's our sun and our Earth and our year. So So we do everything based on us. And what's your first name?
Colin.
Colin. It's like if we had a unit of measure that was based on your height. And we call it a Colin. So, you know, you're two Colins tall, and I'm one and a half Colins tall, and you're one Colin tall. So you'd be the reference. Except that your height changes. And it turns out all of our things change too. Earth doesn't stay constant. We don't have an exact orbit around the sun. So even a light year, you got to kind of fudge. Okay, I'm putting the number here, even though I know it's not perfect. So that's how we do these things. Yes?
So if you're seeing something
like I'll get to you.
So many light years away, you're basically seeing into the past. So is there any way that any type of
you know, there's a reason I have the TARDIS on my cell phone. I am hoping we'll be able to account for that at some point. But with our technology now, not yet. But maybe you could work on that and solve that problem. What was your question in the back?
Can that or could the Kepler see infrared?
Kepler cannot see infrared, which is why we need to build another telescope to look directly. I mean, that's the thing. Kepler said, hey, this cool thing is here. And now we have to develop the telescope that can look at this in the infrared and get all the information we're missing. So yes, we're working on it. Yes?
Is there any coordinated effort among astronomers to focus some of these Earth-based arrays of I guess you'd call them microphones, to see if there would be any kind of patterns of any kind coming from these particular possible sources of light, whatever.
So,
are we doing
so
anything there? Yeah.
This is, well, first off, trying to get astronomers to agree is like herding cats.
Okay,
so that's point one. Point two, this is why you have private organizations like SETI, that Search for Extraterrestrial
right, okay.
Intelligence, that should be the slide up. So where the government doesn't want to go, a private organization will. And this is why you donate to places like LTO, right? You donate to private organizations who will do the things you want them to do. So if, you know, NASA or the European Space Agency doesn't want to look for life, SETI sure does, and that's why they have their own telescope array, which is privately funded, and this is why they have volunteers on their website, so all of that's donated time. So, yeah, one way or the other, yes, you will get there, and we're not there yet, but the mechanisms are in place.
Let me jump in. Any kid or any adult that would like to start looking through a telescope is free to go up. We have
yay!
The telescope. Suzanne can keep
I'll
this all
here.
Night long, probably. So,
but I think you should go look at Saturn. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it.